or also you can find it via the web.
So, yeah. Okay. Okay, great. Thank you. So, during my talk today, I'm going to try to merge traffic models, non-equilibrium traffic models, and growth laws. So that is the starting point. So the question that this week, last week, we have seen several times. We have the famous growth laws, which are relations between physiological state, like the growth rate, and the ribosome allocation, so the ribosome protein fraction. And so I'll try to make a model during this talk today that will be in between these more phenomenological models and the very refined models, mechanistic models like the one that we've seen presented by Andrea Weiss last week. So I think that was the first derivation of the growth laws, mathematical derivation. So we have, we can write the biomass production, like which is should be proportional to the number of active ribosomes times well a time scale that will be the codon elongation rate. So how fast the ribosome, an active ribosome, can attach an amino acid to the growing peptide. So if you do the simple calculation, you will obtain these growth laws. So I will start with a quite long introduction now. It's going to be quite long, but I think it will be useful for what comes afterwards. And to start with, I would like to start where I come from. So I come from a community, a community not that well, a community that is doing models of messenger RNA translation. And what I've been doing was like to estimate the what is called the translation efficiency. So let's say the ribosome flow along the messenger RNA chain, which in principle can depend on many things, like the codon choice that you have, the initiation rates. And actually, in this community, initiation rate is thought to be the limiting, the very important limiting step. So the ribosome recruitment is a central point of translation efficiency. So now, if we go back to the growth laws, my question when I first saw them, okay, I see that how much you produce is proportional to the amount of ribosomes, okay? So the ribosome recruitment must be important, but I don't see it explicit in the formulation of the growth laws. So there is no initiation rate. We can see only the elongation rate. So last part of the talk today, so the main objective of the talk will be to include initiation in this picture. And to start with, I start from the other community where I come from. So it's the non-equilibrium unidimensional traffic, which is called, well, I'll tell you what it's called. So the exclusion process is the model that I'll be using today. It's a unidimensional traffic model in which you have particles, so you have to think that these particles are ribosomes, for instance, joining the lattice with a given rate, and that will be the initiation. We'll call the initiation alpha, so alpha is the tentative rate for initiating translation. Then a particle move along the lattice with a translation elongation rate, which I will always call epsilon. But, well, if there are two particles next to each other, they cannot move, in the sense that one particle cannot overtake another particle. And that is what we call the traffic effect, ribosome interference, if you want. And then, of course, there is termination. At the end, you pop out the messenger RNA and you produce the protein. So this model has been introduced in the 68 by McDonough and co-workers. And it was actually for modeling messenger RNA translation. And it's called the totally asymmetric simple exclusion process. So totally asymmetric because, well, there is a preferred direction from here, from the left to the right, the movement. Exclusion process because the only interaction that we have is the exclusion, the steric exclusion between two particles. And simple because that is the only interaction that we have. So total symmetric simple exclusion process for friends at TASEP. Okay? And so if you have questions, so don't hesitate to interrupt. So what I'm going to show you is the simple model that was sketched before with particles covering just one side of the lattice. But actually, I want to do models of translation, so I'm considering bigger particles. So a ribosome covers more or less 10 codons. Okay, and since, well, anyway, I will show the equations and I will explain everything as if the particle will cover one side. The equation will change, will be more complicated, but qualitatively, the things do not change. So, how does it work? So we can measure, if we know the parameters, so the initiation, the elongation, and the termination rate, we can evaluate the particle density, so how many ribosomes you have, okay, on your lattice, and the particle current that will be linked to the protein synthesis rate. And at the end, that will be linked with growth. And the phenomenology is quite, it's quite simple. So the current is the probability that you have a particle on one side, that is a rho, times the probability that the next side is empty, that is 1 minus rho. And then epsilon is the fixed at the time scale of the process. And so that is a parabola. And if you keep increasing the density, well, the particle current goes up, so you produce more and more. But at some point, traffic effects become relevant, so you saturate. That is what is called the maximal current phase. And then if you keep increasing the density, well, then you will have more and more traffic, so you will even decrease the particle current, so your protein synthesis rate. So how do you fix the particle density? Well, the particle density is fixed by the boundaries, so the initiation and the termination. And that is the very well-known phase diagram of the process. So intuitively, you are in a low-density phase, with just a few particles on the lattice, if the initiation is limiting, and that is what is going to be our physiological important regime. You are in a high-density phase if termination is limiting, so you have lots of particles queuing up. And the maximal current phase, which has a density which is always 1/2, is at the maximum of this parabola. So what can we do with this model? So the model, as I told you, has been introduced at the end of the 60s. Okay, and then it was kind of forgotten for a long time. And then physicists started taking over, discover it. And actually, it's the TASEP is the prototypical model of non-equilibrium systems, which can be solved exactly today. So, but then in the last years, been used again as a model for translation. Yes.
Perhaps it's a very trivial question. So I don't understand why you say that people believe that we are in the, I mean, bacteria operates in the initiation limited phase. Yeah. I didn't understand what is the evidence for, I mean.
I'm going to tell you now. I mean, there are some, I'm going to tell you this slide. So what can we do with the model? Well, if we know the rates, we can even solve it, or we can simulate the model and get to the density and the current. So let's say for now that we know the elongation rate that can be estimated according to the concentration of tRNAs, but roughly this can also be measured. Order of magnitude is 10 amino acids per second, so the speed of the ribosome. And there are some experimental measurement of ribosome densities. So if we know the experimental ribosome density, knowing the elongation rates, we can get the initiation rates. And that's what we did 10 years ago. So like 10 years ago, we did that for ISTA. And for ISTA, we found that the initiation rate, well, among different genes is quite broadly distributed, but on average is 0.12 per second, while the elongation rate is 10 per second, so two order of magnitude difference between the two. That doesn't mean that codons are not important, so they still play a role, but the initiation rate is the most limiting process during elongation. And then there are also experimental measurements, other theoretical works, and I can confirm these values in East. And I'm not sure if there are some estimates in E. coli, but in principle it can be done if there are some ribosome density. So it can be measured directly.
This alpha might vary a lot across different mRNAs of different genes, right?
This alpha vary a lot, that's what the question.
It may, yeah. I'm assuming it might even be orders of magnitude different for different genes.
Yes, I mean, it could vary a lot. It could depend on sequences upstream of the start codons, for instance. So what we found in NISTA, that actually varies quite a lot from the distribution of the initiation rate that we could find. Experimentally, I think you don't see order of magnitudes difference between different initiation rates. And there's the recent paper by Terry Wa's group. They could estimate, so they don't measure directly alpha, but they could estimate starting from ribosome densities. And so the distribution was quite peaked of the initiation rates. So, but there are no extensive measurements of initiation rates. So that is I just said. So there are simple equations that can relate current, yes.
So the initiation rate can also be limited by the density, right? It could just be that you have to wait until the initiation site is free, right?
Okay, there is a big, I think in the literature, there is a big misunderstanding what initiation rate is. I completely agree. But so initiation rate is the tentative of initiating. So is the probability per unit time that you bind here on the first site if there is nothing. Then, if you have the first site that are occupied, okay, then the effective initiation rate will go down. And since you always assume steady state, or I mean, I will always assume steady state, that is equal to the current. So the initiation rate and the current are two different things because they're affected by the traffic. Okay, that's debated. There was this ramp hypothesis, and I think in the last months there has been another paper discussing about this ramp hypothesis, so that at the beginning of the coding sequence you have a slow ramp of codons. But I don't know if that is still valid, but anyway, the first codons has been proved, experimented, that really matters on the final thing. So if you change the first codons, and that's actually my next slide here, if you change the first codons, you're gonna strongly affect the current because you're gonna affect the recruitment of the ribosomes. So actually that is quite important. So if the codons in principle can, the speed of the codon in principle can change, right, from codon to codon, but that's the big problem of codon usage and codon bias. And so in this case, we can forget about this simple solution. Okay, there is no exact solution, so it's still an open problem. In the last years, we developed a power series approximation of the steady state solution of the TASEP when the initiation is limiting. So in this case, we know we have an approximate solution, and we can do it for any order of the approximation. But the important thing, I think, is that we still find in this solution that the ribosome density depends only not on the absolute values of elongation and initiation rates, but on the ratio of the two.
I'm sorry, now yes. The elongation rate depends on the site.
And exactly.
The sequential disorder.
In principle, elongation rate can depend on the site.
And the sequential disorder.
Yes, and then you know, I don't know.
Well,
no, well, you can give a sequence and then you compute the outcome. So then you can do different things, but it will strongly depend on the position of on the actual sequence of the
epsilon. Yes, but the sequence, once you choose the position, this is the.
Yeah. And actually, we now have a Python package, if you're interested, that can develop this TASEP approximation. But so far, okay, the important point is that the no-code on usage has been included so far in these growth laws frameworks. But okay, the take-home message of this slide is that densities will depend only on the ratio between elongation and on the ratio between initiation and elongation. So I think that at the end is always a balance between how well you recruit ribosome and how fast they go, so between initiation and elongation. So let's take this picture in which initiation is faster than elongation. Then you might be happy because you have a larger protein synthesis. At some point, you might even saturate. But actually, there are a lot of resources. When I talk about the resource, I mainly think about the ribosomes that are used. On the other picture, you can have a stronger elongation, faster elongation, and a slower initiation. But in this case, you will have a lower protein synthesis. And on the other way, less resources are used. So some time ago, we analyzed some ribosome profiling in yeast. So substantially, in this experiment, you have the ribosome footprints for each position. So it's a proxy for ribosome density on each codon. And then with our approximation, so by feeding the data into the model, we could estimate the initiation efficiency, so how well the ribosome will initiate, considering this traffic effect, and how well the ribosome will elongate, so when it doesn't find traffic. And so each point here is one gene in yeast that we could analyze. And when initiation is efficient but elongation is low, so there is a lot of ribosome interference, so traffic. And so ribosome resources are wasted because when there is traffic, you don't contribute a lot to the final protein synthesis. And instead, effective elongation, weak initiation, will still finely tune production with codon choices, but you will not have a waste of ribosomal resources. So okay, that was my big, larger motivation section. So now I try to go back to the slow growth, to the growth laws, and to the growth laws, and I will try to implement what I said before. So the biomass production for me now will be not something that is proportional to the active ribosome, but more generally, I will say that is the ribosomal flow, that was J here. And then you have, it will depend on M, which is here the how many messengers in A you have. And then in principle, you can have a degradation. I will come back to that later. So far, there is no degradation in the model. So what I'm assuming is that the initiation rate will depend on the amount of free ribosomes that you have, the concentration of free ribosomes, times rate constant that I call alpha on. And with that, I can compute how many ribosomes are bound. So it will be just the density of the ribosome on one lattice times the length of the messenger RNA. But I don't have just one messenger. I can also compute the current, okay, like the questions we saw before. I can, if I know the bound ribosome, I can compute the free ribosomes. But there is not only one messenger, there are many messengers, so the bound ribosome will depend on the total amount of messengers that you have. So at the end, I can write, if I put everything together, I can write how the initiation rate will depend on the free ribosome, knowing that the free ribosomes are a function now of the total ribosomes, but also on something that reminds the ribosome density, anyway, the elongation rate, but importantly also on the messenger RNA amount that you have. So I can write this in at least two different ways. I quite like writing that in this way. because you see that if you increase the amount of messenger RNA that you have, your initiation rate will go down because there is a competition between the different messengers. So I would say that this way of writing thing highlight the competition that you have among different messengers. And that is substantially what Ludo presented last week. So there is the complex formation limitation, what we called. And so if you want to know more, you should see Ludo's talk of last week. So now I know the initiation, I can put everything back in the growth law. So I know that, okay, I know the current, I know the amount of messenger, so I can compute how lambda depend on phi r, but importantly, we depend also on the concentration of messenger RNA. So if we neglect the traffic, you get exactly the complex formation limitation that Ludo presented last week. And so there is a preprintout if you're interested here. I'm sure that you talked with Ludovico already. So if you consider traffic, you have to consider this factor here. And now I want to show you two applications of this framework. So one is what Philippe has talked last year, so I go very quickly about that because you probably remember the talk, but there are new people, so I just do a very quick presentation about that, and then something about the work that Johannes is doing. And the first work is also in collaboration with Ludovico and Marco. So in Philippe's model, so we can use exactly the same framework that I presented for translation, but coupling also transcription as well. So we have two different models, so I don't fix the amount of messenger RNA, but the amount of messenger RNA is given by the transcription model. So we have two different currents, the currents of transcription that will depend on the amount of genes that you have and the amount of polymerases that I call N here, and the current of translation that will depend on the amount of messenger RNAs that you have and the amount of ribosomes that you have. And then, of course, the output we are interested in is growth. So we can be with both systems in low density. So there are four options, low density, or you can saturate like transcription and low density for translation, or you can have low density for transcription and high density, or anyway, saturation for translation, or everything is saturated. So we can make a phase diagram out of it. And so if we change the polymerase concentration of the ribosome concentration, you will get these four different regimes. And physiologically, we are mainly, unless if you put some stress, then we still don't know where we are. But physiologically, we are on these along this line here. So that is a isodensity line. So when we fix the density of the ribosome, that is what has been experimentally seen, at least in one of the last papers of Terry Was group. So assuming that the density is constant, what can we say along this line? And we know the density is more or less of four ribosomes per messenger RNA, and apparently doesn't change a lot at different conditions. So let's start by assuming that we move on this density, so that somehow ribosome density is regulated across different conditions. And what can we obtain? So if we move along this density, this isodensity line, so here there are, in red, you see the estimated mRNA synthesis fluxes from the Balakrishnan et al. Paper last year. Yes?
The four ribosomes per mRNA are like including the inactive ones.
No. No, that's the actual density.
They don't
have a direct measurement of that, but they could estimate measuring the elongation and the initiation rate. So they have this estimate. And they observe that it doesn't change across the condition. So Assuming that we are on these isodensity lines, what can our model could say? So these are the data from their group. And this is the theoretical prediction. So substantially here, there are no fitting parameters. So we just fitted the model with the data. And we obtain, we can predict the mRNA synthesis flux, which is going to be.
Can you clarify the units on the y-axis per minute per micrometer?
I think I plotted it wrong. It should be volume, right?
Per unit volume.
Yeah. Is it right?
Yeah, okay. It should be per mRNA concentration or per mRNA. I'm a bit confused.
Yeah, but concentration is a number per volume, so it should be.
But that might change with growth rate too, no? The concentration of the mRNAs.
Yes, but that is in the concentration of messenger RNA changes with volume, with the growth rate, but that's in the model. So the concentration.
But that's but that's exactly why I'm asking, right? Because if the y-axis is per concentration mRNA, then you've taken care of whatever change in concentration of mRNAs with growth rate. But if it's per unit volume, then it still also depends on how the concentration of mRNA changes per unit volume. Right? It changes the growth rate.
Okay, we can. Well, we should talk later. Okay.
It still depends.
Yeah, but that is all average. I mean, all the genes.
So the assumption is the DNA concentration.
So the assumption is also all the genes are the same.
Sorry.
And also on the same line, so they have measurements of ribosome concentration and RNAP concentrations. And well, we can quite reproduce the experimental value without imposing any fitting on the model. Okay, that is a lot of work in progress. So if you have ideas or questions, just come to me or Filippo or Ludovico, who is also involved. And now I would like to go a bit more slowly on the second part. And here, so I was thinking that I would like to spoil Johannes' presentation for last talk on Friday. But okay, I'm not going to do that. I'm going to more talk here about the role of initiation of translation. So I come back to my motivations, my first motivation. So that is our starting point, right? The question from the framework there that I showed you before. And so I told you that in my motivation, so I wanted to highlight the role of initiation because in the translation community is really important. So the initiation here is hidden in this K, so this constant array, the affinity, let's say, of messenger RNA and ribosomes. So what can we take from the literature are the experimental data on the messenger RNA concentrations. The elongation rate has been measured. So we have seen the talk last week. And well, of course, the ribosome number fraction has been measured. So I have all the ingredients here, okay, to infer my initiation rate. And that's what I'm going to do now. So, but let me write maybe the initiation in this way. So I'll put all the regulation that can happen on the initiation on a factor F, okay? That will be something between 0 and 1. And it regulates the initiation of translation, okay? It could be for many different reasons. I don't know why. It could be for initiation factors. It could be for hibernating factors, sequestering the free ribosomes. So, but I'm putting all the regulation into that. And now I would like to estimate F substantially. So when we do that with our model, we'll see that, so that is as a function of growth rate, this F parameter, which is going up and then it saturates. So it's going up, it means that here, at very slow growth, substantially you have no initiation. Okay? Somehow you are regulating in a way that you don't initiate messenger RNA translation. And because of that, you see you accumulate free ribosomes. You accumulate free ribosomes in your pool. So, and F describes all kind of regulations, and I think the most accepted view is to consider that ribosomes are sequestered by some hibernating factors. So that is what alpha will look like. So that is as a function of the growth rate. Alpha will tend to zero and then will saturate at some point. And that is similar to the order of magnitude of what I told you at the beginning for EAST. So for EAST, the average behavior was 0.12 per second, order of magnitude. And here we are the order of 0.3 per second of fast growth. And remember that so the elongation rate is order of tenths per second, so still a two order of magnitude different. So initiation is still limiting and should be important. So now let me plot the estimated initiation as a function of the number fraction, okay, phi r. And so we see this, there is a offset in phi r, and substantially that will be the amount of free ribosomes that you have at zero growth. Exactly like this, so the two things should match. But exactly, so that's the amount of, that will correspond to the amount of free ribosomes that you get here. But anyway, I think, and it was, I think, done questions in the first week, so what about initiation, I mean, what about inactive ribosome at zero growth? So you have not zero, you have zero active ribosomes, but you still can measure elongation rates. So that is a bit inconsistent, right? So, because you can still measure some elongation rates, but you have nothing that is actually initiating translation. So that is something that is there in the simple model of having inactive active ribosomes. So at zero growth, you extrapolate, you should have no biosynthesis, but it's a bit inconsistent with the fact that you can still measure elongation rates. So how do we want to, how can we fix it? Well, we thought that to fix it by including protein degradation. And so the next couple of slides that I'm going to present are actually the work in collaboration with Ludovico, Marco. For Marco, I found a very nice figure in the lab coat. And also with Jacopo, who is here. And so Ludovico went back to the literature, and there is actually not much literature about protein degradation, but we could find papers from the 70s, 80s. I didn't put the references here, but you can find them in our paper. And so we first try to see if, because everyone says that we can neglect the protein degradation, so is it still true that we can neglect the protein degradation at slow growth? So we can neglect it if degradation and dilution, they are very different, but at slow growth, the two things might become comparable. And when we went back to the literature and analyzed the data, so Ludo found that degradation rate is actually increasing at slow growth. These are data from the 70s paper. And so in the next, so what I will show later, I'm just assuming that this trend, the fitted curve here. And the same thing seems to happen in EAST as well. And we would like to do more accurate measurements of what happens here, because it's something that hasn't been explored so far that much. So anyway, let's go back to the contradiction in the active inactive ribosome at slow growth. So we substantially, our hypothesis that there are some ribosomes that are doing protein synthesis, but do not actually contribute to growth, but actually do maintenance to balance the degradation flux. So, and if we do that, you can have a model with inactive ribosome, free ribosome, bound ribosome, and the bound ribosome can do maintenance or contribute to growth. And if you estimate the fraction of bound ribosome, including this term from the data, which are the crosses here, you see that actually the amount of active ribosome doesn't go to zero, but there is still an offset in the amount of ribosome that are translating, extrapolating the results at zero growth. So, and that is the paper that we published last year. So, now, let's go back to the initiation problem that we have. So, we have the problem that at zero growth, so here I plot in phi r, so that's phi r mean here. I have no initiation, that is bring without the degradation, the model that I explained before. If I include degradation, I can actually, of course, I can see an offset in the initiation rate at phi r mean. So it means alpha zero here is the initiation rate that we expect to have at zero growth. And substantially, that is kind of consistent now in the sense that you measure some elongation rates. Also initiation, some elongation rates that don't go to zero, you still have a protein expression, protein synthesis at zero growth. So the same thing should kind of happen with the initiation. And so now these are preliminary data again, so we'll try to do some more refined work on that. No, yes, so I plot, so you're right. So that is not lambda, so that's phi r mean, so it's the famous phi r mean, is the offset in the growth law. I could have plotted it to zero, but it's easier to see that at phi r mean, when you're at zero growth, you have no, you still have some elongation rate and initiation rates that are different from zero. So it's just because it's easier. I could have plotted that as a function of alpha. So, and now let's go back to my motivation, because remember, the ribosome density should be a function of the ratio, right? Of the initiation rate and the elongation rate. So now I can compute, actually, the ribosome density for different growth rate, can compute the ribosome density for different growth rate. That is what we obtain. So that's the ribosome density as a function of the growth rate, assuming the epsilon, so the elongation rates and initiation rates that we estimated. And for fast growth, we are at a constant ribosome density, and the gray line that is here is for more or less 4.5 ribosomes. Messenger RNA, that is what it has been previously estimated. And actually, the lowest value here is for more or less three ribosomes for messenger RNA. So there is no big difference. So we don't have any mechanism yet on how initiation is actually regulated. We think that most of the thing could be hibernating ribosomes. But it seems that one of the outcome of having these both elongation and initiation regulated is actually to keep the ribosome density more or less constant across conditions. Yes.
Again, a super basic question. So, do you use these? I didn't understand when you were talking about the paper by Balakrishnan. I don't understand if you use the fact that the ribosome density is constant. To infer this, so it's really
that's an outcome of I was a bit confused in the first application. So Philippe's model that he presented last week, yes, we are assuming that ribosome density is more or less constant, and in this part, so when we estimate initiation here, there is no assumption on the ribosome density. So the only inputs that we have are those. So the messenger RNA concentration, the elongation rate, and phi r. So these are the only input that we feed into the model. And then with these, we can estimate an initiation rate. And as an outcome, we have that the density is more or less constant. Okay, and I think I can wrap up. Yes.
Okay, so my question is the offset an input of your model or an output from the degradation that you have as an input?
So okay, the question, if I understand, is if the phi r mean here is an input of the model or an output, right? I mean, it's in the data, right, that we are giving to, it's in this data here, the offset. Yeah, I mean, yes, and we, yes, I mean, yes, being the data, yes, they are in the input of the model substantially. But, the degradation rate is necessary. So the degradation rate can give you the offset, okay? If you don't have this as an input, if you change the degradation rate, it will give you the offset substantially. So now, if you analyze the data, so if you have an input with an offset and you don't have degradation rate, you arrive to something that is inconsistent, like that you don't have initiation, but you have you measure elongation, right? So if you the degradation is not a fit, is actually taking the data from the literature. So also the degradation is an input. So if you take the model without considering degradation, you arrive at an inconsistent result. If you add the degradation, data from the literature, you get to a value of initiation with an offset.
But is the offset that's observed also?
This offset, well, is not observed in the sense there are no measurements of initiation rates, as far as I'm aware, across different conditions. But I could estimate that starting from the data. So one thing to do would be probably to measure these initiation rates, which can be done. Yeah.
So regarding the degradation, that means that, like, experimentally, if you were to manage to, like, increase the degradation, you would see in these data from Dai et al. That the offset of sort of the number of the fraction of ribosome at zero growth would go up.
So the if I understand the question, you're saying if you add more degradation, you should see that the data will go up.
Yeah.
Well, no, I don't think so. I mean, the data are the data. So I trust, I mean, you take this data as an input. But it will probably change the interpretation that you give to the data. So if you increase, consider no degradation, the offset is given by inactivated ribosomes. So how can you test this offset? Well, probably by changing the gradation, you should change the offset, that's for sure. I don't know what else can happen to the cell, but yeah.
One more question.
So you said there are no measurements of initiation rate, but I'm just wondering, maybe I'm missing something, but isn't it just the number of ribosomes divided by the number of mRNA copies? I mean, aren't all the ribosomes on some mRNA?
No, I wouldn't say so. So the question is the initiation rate just the number of ribosomes divided by the number of messenger RNA, right?
In the cell, yeah.
No, because that will give you the current. So the current is a combination, is a function of both initiation and elongation.
Yeah.
And I want to decouple these two terms.
No, but that's, so you're saying if, I'm just saying, like, sorry, okay, so you also need to know how long it takes to finish the translation.
Well, but even if you know how long it takes to finish, I mean, if you measure just protein synthesis, it will be like the time that you need to initiate, time that plus the times that you need to translate. Right?
Yeah, so okay, so there's not everything is known, you're saying?
No,
okay.
So the elongation rates that have been measured in the data that I show you is actually the translation of the first ribosome, so the first, so it doesn't see any traffic.
Yeah.
So that should be something that is very close to the microscopic elongation rate. If you want to do that at a steady state, let's say, you're actually measuring the current.
Right.
But you're not measuring elongation or initiation. So I want to do a microscopic model starting from these two terms. Okay, but I think I can wrap up. So just to make a quick summary, so what I've done, I presented a slightly more general framework that can consider for a complex formation limitation, so the fact that you have competition among the messengers for the ribosomes, and which also includes traffic. So we can use, we can then build up on this framework. We can couple transcription and translation. And that's been the toys that Ludovico and Philippe did last week. And we can investigate also the role of translation initiation. And also the message here is be careful because protein degradation shouldn't be neglected at slow growth when the two, the dilution term and the degradation terms becomes all the same order. Now, we can build and do a lot of things from now on. And the idea now is to perturb different steps of translation. So perturb not just elongation, how it has been done in the literature. We can perturb initiation, or we can perturb like with antibiotics that will affect on different different ways than just chloramphenicol, for instance. So and with that, I would like to thank all these people, in particular Alphilippe and Johannes, who are here. And well, of course, thank you for listening.
Yeah, thanks for that very interesting talk. I'm confused about something. You, at some point, you showed a graph of ribosomal fraction versus growth rate, the straight line which you mentioned was being done without any fitting any parameters to the data. Can you just go back to that?
Yes, I was, okay, probably I went too fast on that part. Like these?
Ribosome concentration, yes, versus lab, right.
Substantially here, the thing that we did was to couple transcription and translation, and then we can have a phase diagram according if you are in the saturated regimes or not, or in the, let's say, low density regime, as a function of RNAP concentration and ribosome concentration. And then we said, okay, now we know from data that the ribosome density is constant on the transcript. So we assume that, and there is a one isodensity line that fixes the density at 4 ribosome per messenger RNA. So what happens on this line? Now the question, what happens on this line? Well, we can, so I think that was the question. So we can see how, as a function of growth rate, being on this isodensity line, the ribosome concentration will change and the RNAP concentration will change. So, and that is the plot that I showed here.
So what is confusing me, to ask my question, is that I thought that this particular straight line is a consequence of some regulation, which is the balance, which is what the cell does to, you know, to regulate the balance between ribosomal protein and metabolic protein. Now, where is that sort of conceptually entering your?
You're right. So the regulation is here by imposing that you are. You want to live on an isodensity line that you somehow the cells regulate the ribosome density to be constant across different conditions. So we, when we look at what happens around this line here, it's where we implicitly put all the regulations that we're selling.
I see. So that's where. But why is that a balance between ribosomal protein versus metabolic protein?
I don't think we can answer with this model. Mm. But yeah, you're right. Everything is implicit. Yeah.
More questions?
So with all these offsets and the degradation rate not being ignorable, is it more natural to look at growth rate plus degradation rate in all the plots? Or would something else go wrong in your model?
Sorry, I didn't understand the question. Is it more reasonable to look at?
So as you always plot things versus a growth rate, right? All these plots are. But then you say the degradation rate plays the same role as zero growth rate. So isn't it natural to just make all these plots with the growth rate and the degradation rate added? Or do they play a different role somewhere in the model?
No, you're talking about the initiation rate. Why did I choose to plot the initiation rate as a function of phi r, for instance? We have, as an input, we have the phi r, so we have the ribosome function, and we can get to the lambda. But it was just a choice, maybe not a fortunate one.
More questions? I have one.
When you plot, if you go to the ISO line that you showed before. No, all right, yeah. This one there. It seems that you have this limit there, this horizontal line, is a sort of, a phase transition, or is it just something that you just...
You mean here?
No, the horizontal one, the black one.
Ah, here? The center
the horizontal
one.
Yes.
Okay, this one, yes, that's
this
a phase transition.
But
yeah.
You don't see it on the data.
No, we don't see, So by Newton conditions, by changing the condition, we are in this region here.
In this room.
Yeah, in the white one.
It would be nice to see if it changed when you actually, but that because
when
that
you stress.
Would be, yes, because that would be a strong validation of the model, that you can actually see this condition.
I agree.
Right. One more question. Right, we are on time.
Thank you very much.